سَيَقُولُ لَكَ الْمُخَلَّفُونَ مِنَ الْأَعْرَابِ Those who remain behind of the Bedouins will say to you. مُخَلَّفُون is a plural of مُخَلَّف. And who is مُخَلَّف? One who stays behind. One who remains behind while others go. So they remain behind from what? From what? From going with the Prophet ﷺ for Umrah. They did not accompany him when he set out for Makkah. They weren't there at the Bay'a Ridwan. They weren't there at the Treaty of Hudaybiyah. Rather, they stayed back in their homes. And who are these people? Min al-A'rab in particular. A'rab is the plural of A'rabi. And who are the A'rab? The Bedouins, those who live in the desert, not in the city. Who are these Bedouins? These Bedouin tribes, the tribes that lived in the outskirts of Medina, and it is said that they were the tribes of Ghifar, Aslam, Muzayna, Juhayna, Ashja', and some other tribes. So they did not go along the Prophet ﷺ. So when he came back, when he returned, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, they will come and say to you, شَغَلَتْنَا أَمْوَالُنَا وَأَهْلُونَا Our wealth, our properties, and our families, they kept us so busy, we could not come. We just didn't find the time. We were so busy. We were so occupied. شَغَلَتْنَا is from the root letters, شِين غَيْن لَام فِي شُغُلٍ What does that mean? To be occupied with something, to be busy with something, and in particular in something important because of which you can't think of anything else. So our amwal and our ahloon, this is actually ahloonana, one noon has been omitted. And ahloon is a plural of ahl. So who is ahl? Family. So our properties and our families, they kept us so busy, there was so much to do, we just didn't have time to come. And we were afraid that if we left them, if we left our families, if we left our homes, our properties, then they would suffer. We had to take care of them. We're so sorry we couldn't come along. فَاسْتَغْفِرْ لَنَا So seek forgiveness for us. Just like people say, remember us in your prayers. You're so righteous, I can't do anything. I'm very busy. Therefore, you remember me in your prayers. So the munafiqeen also, they came to the Prophet ﷺ and they said, شَغَلَتْنَا أَمْوَالُنَا وَأَهْلُونَا فَاسْتَغْفِرْ لَنَا Isn't this scary? Many times, what is it that prevents a person from fulfilling the commitment he has made with Allah? What's the big excuse? My house, my money, my job, my family, my this, my that. Who used to say this? The munafiqeen. Because the believers never gave preference to their own wealth, their own families above the religion of Allah. Allah and His Messenger came first. Which is why at Tabuk, when Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he had to bring his entire wealth, he did it. He did it. When they had to travel for weeks and weeks, they went, leaving behind their families. The Prophet ﷺ himself, when he went for battle once, his own daughter was ill, at the verge of dying, at the Battle of Badr. He didn't stay behind, he went. Because for a believer, his top priority is his commitment that he has made with Allah. So he cannot come up with the excuse, شَغَلَتْنَا أَمْوَالُنَا وَأَهْلُونَا Okay, yes, sometimes unusual circumstances do come up, right? Or unexpected difficulties do come up. That's not the norm. Sometimes it does happen, and that's understandable. But to make this a justification every single time, I'm too busy, I cannot do this. I'm too busy, I cannot that. I cannot do that. And staying away from one opportunity after the other, saying, شَغَلَتْنَا أَمْوَالُنَا وَأَهْلُونَا This is a great loss for a person. A great loss for a person. Because the same wealth, these same children, they're not going to be there forever. They will keep you busy, consume your time, consume your energy. But at the end, what do you have with you? What do you have to show to your Lord? And eventually, they will come to an end and you will be left alone. شَغَلَتْنَا أَمْوَالُنَا وَأَهْلُونَا فَاسْتَغْفِرْ لَنَا Seek forgiveness for us. Allah says, يَقُولُونَ بِأَلْسِنَتِهِمْ They're saying with their tongues, مَا لَيْسَ فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ Which is not actually in their hearts. Meaning it's not that they really wanted to go and their families and their properties actually kept them busy. No. It's not that they really want you to seek forgiveness. They're just saying it just to please you. This is not coming from their heart. Allah says, قُلْ say to them, فَمَنْ يَمْلِكُ لَكُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ شَيْئًا Who owns for you, who possesses for you against Allah anything at all? إِنْ أَرَادَ بِكُمْ ضَرًّا If he intended evil for you, أَوْ أَرَادَ بِكُمْ نَفْعًا Or he intended benefit for you. If Allah wants to send some evil your way, can anyone save you? No. In your own house that you're busy with your own children that you can't get away from, your own family that you cannot bear to be away from for even a moment, for even a day, for even a few hours. If sitting amongst them, sitting in your own house, if Allah intends to send some harm upon you, can anyone rescue you? Can anyone save you? They cannot save you. No one can save you. And if you go out in the way of Allah, Allah gives you some nafar, Allah gives you some benefit. Can anyone deprive you of that benefit? No. Because when a person does not go out in the way of Allah, what does he think? What stops him? Something might happen. But the fact is that something might happen even when you're at home. Even when you're busy with your wealth and your family. Something can happen even at that time. A person does not go thinking he will get benefit. But the fact is you can even get benefit when you're out in the way of Allah. Allah says, بَلْ كَانَ اللَّهُ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ خَبِيرًا But rather Allah is ever with whatever you do, aware, acquainted. You cannot hide from Him. You can deceive people. You can lie to them. You can present many excuses before them. But Allah is fully aware. Allah knows which excuse is really an excuse and which excuse is just something to get away with. بَلْ كَانَ اللَّهُ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ خَبِيرًا And we see that a person usually lies to the other because he's concerned about his appearance. Isn't it so? Let me present this excuse because otherwise I will look bad. But a person should be concerned about his image before who? His Lord. Because بَلْ كَانَ اللَّهُ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ خَبِيرًا At the end of the day, your matter is with Allah. Your commitment is with Allah, not with the people. And Allah knows what you do. In Surah Al-Ahzab, ayah 17, قُلْ مَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يَعْصِمُكُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ إِنْ أَرَادَ بِكُمْ سُوءًا أَوْ أَرَادَ بِكُمْ رَحْمَةً وَلَا يَجِدُونَ لَهُمْ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ وَلِيًّا وَلَا نَصِيرًا Who can save you if Allah intends to send some evil upon you or He intends to send some rahmah upon you? People think if they go, they will get sick. You can even get sick in your own house. People think if they go, they will not eat. You can also eat outside. The thing is that all good, all harm comes from who? Allah. When you're out in His way, you think He will not help you? You think He will not protect you? When He is the one who sends everything your way, when you're out for the sake of Allah, Allah's help is with you. So why do you worry? بَلْ ظَنَنْتُمْ Rather you thought. The munafiqeen, this was a real problem. That you thought, أَلَّنْ يَنْقَرِبَ الرَّسُولُ وَالْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهِمْ أَبَدًا You thought that the messenger and the believers will never return to their families ever. This is what you thought, and this is why you didn't go with them. You thought they're going to Makkah, where the enemy is. In the mouth of the enemy they're going. They're never coming back. This is why you never went with them. وَزُّيِّنَ ذَٰلِكَ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ And this was adorned in your hearts. What? This thought that the messenger, the believers, they're never coming back. This thought seemed very good to you, and this is why you stayed behind. It wasn't that you were actually very busy with your family and your wealth. No. You didn't go because you thought they were never coming back. You thought they were going to die. You thought they were going to be killed, and you didn't want to be killed. This is why you didn't go. وَظَنَنْتُمْ ظَنَّ السَّوءِ And you thought an evil thought. About who? About Allah. وَكُنْتُمْ قَوْمًا بُورًا And you are a people who are bur, bound to ruin. Bur is a plural of the word ba'ir. And ba'ir from the root letters ba wa ra is one to be destroyed. And ba'ir is also understood as fasid, a bad person, one who is foul, one who is wicked. So it gives us two meanings, doomed to ruin and also an evil person, a fasid person, wicked person. So وَكُنْتُمْ قَوْمًا بُورًا, and you are a people who are bound to be destroyed. You didn't go thinking you'll be saved. You will be destroyed. You will suffer. وَكُنْتُمْ قَوْمًا بُورًا, you didn't go because you are fasid people. You're sinful people. So in other words, you're lagging behind. It was not an excusable act. It was not because you were busy. It was not because you had a genuine reason. No. Your lagging behind was because of hypocrisy, because of bad thoughts. You thought if you go out in the way of Allah, you're going to suffer. This is what you thought. You didn't have good thoughts about Allah. This is why you didn't go. وَكُنْتُمْ قَوْمًا بُورًا. And a person who has bad thoughts ends up suffering evil as well. Because what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say? I am as my servant thinks I am. Whatever you expect, that's what you will get. You expected evil, you will get evil even in your own homes. وَكُنْتُمْ قَوْمًا بُورًا. And sometimes it happens that a person does not go out in the way of Allah, and he thinks that he will be saved, but in fact, he is still in trouble. One difficulty after the other. So staying away does not mean ease, and going out does not mean difficulty. Difficulty and ease are a part of life. They come by the decree of Allah. You have to respond to the call whenever it's made. وَمَنْ لَمْ يُؤْمِنْ بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ, and whoever has not believed in Allah and His Messenger, فَإِنَّا أَعْتَدْنَا لِلْكَافِرِينَ سَعِيرًا, then indeed we have prepared for the disbelievers a blaze, a warning. Whoever does not believe in Allah and His Messenger, then for him is prepared a blaze. وَلِلَّهِ مُلْكُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ, and to Allah belongs the dominion of the heavens and the earth. يَغْفِرُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيُعَذِّبُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ, He forgives whomever He wills, and He punishes whom He wills. وَكَانَ اللَّهُ غَفُورًا رَحِيمًا, and Allah is also forgiving and merciful. This gives hope that mistakes may happen, but there's always a chance to improve. There is always a chance to reform. سَيَقُولُ الْمُخَلَّفُونَ, those who remain behind will say, when, إِذَا انطلقتم, when you set forth, when you set out. When you set out, انطلقتم, طَالَمْقَ, remember Surah Al-Kahf, فَانْطَلَقَ, so they both set out, they went ahead. So the مخلفون, soon they will say to you, when you set out, إِلَى مَغَانِمَ, to spoils, meaning spoils of war, مغانم, plural of مغنم. When you set out in order to gain مغانم, why? لِتَأْخُذُوهَا, so that you take it. What does it mean by this? Meaning when you set forth, when you set out for an expedition where gaining war booty seems very likely. Why? Because victory seems very likely. Meaning it's not a very difficult expedition, but it's an easy one. It's very easy to be victorious over there. So the مخلفون, those who stayed behind at this time, who didn't go for the purpose of Umrah with you, next time when you set out in order to gain some مغانم, they will say to you, ذَرُونَا, leave us, meaning allow us, just as Fir'aun said, ذَرُونِي أَخْتُ الْمُوسَى. So they will say to you, ذَرُونَا نَتَّبِعْكُمْ, we will follow you, meaning we will come with you. Which expedition does it refer to? This refers to the expedition to Khaybar. Who lived in Khaybar? The Yahud. And remember that they were very wealthy, and they had committed great treachery with the Prophet ﷺ. They had harassed the Muslims a lot, harmed the Muslims a lot, created a lot of fasad and fitna. So, a few months after the treaty of Hudaybiyah, the Prophet ﷺ, because he did not have to worry about the mushrikeen, he paid attention to dealing with the Jews at Khaybar. And because they were very wealthy, if the Muslims were victorious, that meant a lot of war booty. And who gets war booty? The one who participates. Isn't it so? So, the Munafiqeen did not go for Umrah. And now that the Muslims are going for Khaybar, they will say to you, ذَرُونَا نَتَّبِعْكُمْ, allow us, we want to come with you. Allah says, يُرِيدُونَ, these people wish, أَن يُبَدِّلُوا كَلَامَ اللَّهِ, that they change the words of Allah. Which kalam of Allah? Which words of Allah? The words of Allah which say that the spoils of Khaybar are exclusively for those who were at Hudaybiyah. This was a promise of Allah that the spoils of Khaybar exclusively for who? Those who were at Hudaybiyah. Or his command to the Prophet ﷺ that he must not take these people with him on any expedition. Which people? Those who stayed behind from Hudaybiyah. So يُرِيدُونَ أَن يُبَدِّلُوا كَلَامَ اللَّهِ. They know what the ruling is, that only those who participated in Hudaybiyah are going to go there. But they want to change the words of Allah. Allah says, قُلْ say to them, لَن تَتَّبِعُونَ. You will never follow us. Never will you be allowed to follow us. Why? Because كَذَلِكُمْ likewise for you all, meaning in the case of you all, قَالَ اللَّهُ مِنْ قَبْلُ. Allah said before. Allah said with regards to you that you're never coming with us. فَسَيَقُولُونَ, then they will say, بَلْ تَحْسُدُونَنَا, rather you're jealous of us. Can you imagine? You're jealous of us. What a small mind. What a small mind. That you're jealous of us, this is why you don't want me to come. This is why you don't want us to come. Allah says, بَلْ كَانُوا لَا يَفْقَهُونَ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. But rather these people, they do not understand except a little. When it comes to dunya, they use their mind a lot. They're very intelligent. But in reality, the munafiqeen, they lack fiqh. They lack comprehension. They don't have understanding. So over here in this ayah, the believers are being given a preliminary warning that when you're going to set out for Khaybar, this is what the munafiqeen are going to ask. But this is what you're supposed to say to them. Then they will say, you're jealous of us. But just know that these people don't have any fiqh. They don't understand. Therefore, people who don't understand, there is no need to dispute with them. There is no need to argue with them. There is no need to get worked up over there. A person who doesn't understand, just ignore him. In Surah Al-Tawbah, ayah 83, also we learn that the Prophet ﷺ, when he was coming back from Tabuk, it was revealed to him, فَإِن رَجَعَكَ اللَّهُ إِلَىٰ طَائِفَةٍ مِّنْهُمْ فَاسْتَأْذَنُوكَ لِلْخُرُوجِ فَقُلْ لَن تَخْرُجُوا مَعِيَ أَبَدًا. When they ask you to go out with you the next time, say, never will you go out with me again. وَلَن تُقَاتِلُوا مَعِيَ عَدُوًّا. And you will never fight an enemy with me. Because إِنَّكُمْ رَضِيتُمْ بِالْقُعُودِ أَوَّلَ مَرَّةِ فَقْعُدُوا مَعَ الْخَالِفِينَ. You were happy with staying behind the first time, now stay behind with those who stay behind. No more opportunities for you. What's the lesson in this for us? That when an opportunity comes, seize it, grab it, take it, don't stay behind. Because if you stay behind once, then that will be a means of closing doors of future opportunities. Sometimes we wait for other people to go ahead first. We wait for other people to do it. Or we wait for the ideal situation. We say, شَغَلَتْنَا أَمْوَالُنَا وَأَهْلُونَا, I'm too busy right now, I can't do it. But the thing is that the opportunity that's coming right now, you don't know if it's going to come again. You don't know. Like one of the sisters, she was telling me that initially she had decided she wasn't going to do the advanced course, but then later she thought, it's being offered now. I don't know when it's going to be offered next. I have to seize it now. I have to do it now. So this is what we should be thinking. That when an opportunity comes, it comes at that moment, at that point. You don't know when it's coming again. If it's coming again. Therefore, take benefit. Take advantage. And if you refuse once, then you never know. Future doors may be closed as well. So a person has to be very, very careful. قُلْ لِلْمُخَلَّفِينَ مِنَ الْأَعْرَابِ. Say to those who remain behind of the Bedouins. Say to them that سَتُدَعُونَ. Soon you will be called. This opportunity you've lost. You'll be tested again. How? That سَتُدَعُونَ, you will be called إِلَىٰ قَوْمٍ, to a people, to a nation, meaning in order to fight a nation. How is that nation? أُلِي بَأْسٍ شَدِيدٍ. Possessors of great strength. And especially ba's. And what is ba's? What kind of power is ba's? Of fighting. Of great military might. These are the people you'll be called to fight against. And these people, تُقَاتِلُونَهُمْ, either you'll fight them, أَوْ يُسْلِمُونَ, or they will surrender. Meaning there will be no need to fight them. No battle will actually take place. But you will be called. You will have to go all the way. So which people are these? Some have said that it refers to the Battle of Hunayn. This was 6th year of Hijrah. Battle of Hunayn was after the conquest of Makkah. And who are these people? Uli Ba'asin Shadid, the tribes of Hawazin and Saqif. Some have said that it refers to the Persians and the Byzantines. And you see, tud'auna, satud'auna, you will be called. By who? By either the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if he's alive, or the Khalifa, the Amir al-Mu'mineen of the time. Others have said that this qawm refers to the tribe of Banu Hanifa, who were the inhabitants of the region of Yamama. They were the people of Musaylima al-Kadhab. And the battle that was fought with them, it was a big battle. So, satud'auna ila qawmin uli ba'sin shadidin, of great military might. You will be invited to fight them. And the Muslim army, either the Muslim army will fight them, أو يسلمون, or they will submit. فَإِن تُطِيعُوا, then if you obey, يُؤْتِكُمُ اللَّهُ أَجْرًا حَسَنًا, then Allah will give you a good reward. Just imagine how forgiving Allah is. That they refuse to come the first time, entertaining evil, negative thoughts about Allah. But look at the mercy of Allah, that He says He will give another opportunity. Not the Khaybar one, but a later one, which is going to be a much more difficult one. And if you respond, Allah will reward you. وَإِن تَتَوَلَّوْا, but if you turn away, كَمَا تَوَلَّيْتُ مِنْ قَبْلُ, just as you turned away before, يُعَذِّبُكُمْ عَذَابًا أَلِيمًا, He will punish you with a painful punishment. So we see that sometimes mistakes happen. We lose opportunities. We don't benefit from them. And later on we realize our mistake. Isn't it? Does it ever happen? But when we realize our mistake, then we make great promises. If only I could get this chance one more time. One more time only. I will do this, and I will do that, and I will do this. We make great claims, great promises. So then what happens? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests the person. He gives him an opportunity, but that opportunity is a much more difficult one. Much more difficult one. Uli ba'sin shadeed. And at that time a person is being tested. What does he do? Does he fulfill his promise? Does he learn from his mistake and make up for what he missed out before? Or does he remain the same? If he makes up for what he did before, he fixes himself, he fulfills his promise, and Allah will give him a good reward. But if he turns away, then there is a painful punishment. There is a painful punishment then. لَيْسَ عَلَى الْأَعْمَى حَرَجٌ, there is not upon the blind any guilt. There is not upon the blind person any guilt. Which blind person? Who cannot see. Meaning if he stays behind, if he wasn't able to go for the Umrah, if he is not able to participate in battles, then there is no blame on him. Meaning he's not sinful. وَلَا عَلَى الْأَعْرَجِ حَرَجٌ, nor is there any blame on the A'raj, because he cannot walk. وَلَا عَلَى الْمَرِيضِ حَرَجٌ, and nor upon the ill any haraj. Why? Because he's sick. He has a genuine reason, a genuine excuse for staying behind. But وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ, whoever obeys Allah and His Messenger, يُدْخِلْهُ جَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ, He will admit him into gardens underneath which rivers flow. وَمَنْ يَتَوَلَّ, but whoever turns away, يُعَذِّبْهُ عَذَابًا أَلِيمًا, He will punish him with a painful punishment. There are two ways. One way is of obedience, and the other way is of disobedience. A person has to see what he is capable of doing. And then he also has to see what the state of his heart is. There were those who were a'ma, who were mareed, who were a'raj at the time of the Prophet ﷺ. But that did not make them stay behind. Or that did not make them happy on staying behind. They were weeping, they were sad. They were grieved when they couldn't participate, when they couldn't go forth in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So obedience is clear. And disobedience, turning away, that is also clear. The one who obeys, the one who fulfills his commitment, there is a great reward for him. And the one who disobeys, tries to deceive, turns away, then there is also a painful punishment for him. So we always have to be careful that yes, the intention is good, but the action should also follow. Sometimes we just make great claims, but we don't do anything. We also have to do something. And we always have to be hoping for reward from Allah, fearing His punishment. Because when a person thinks of Allah as his boss, not the person, but Allah is my boss, He will hold me accountable, He is the one who's going to pay me, then only his actions can be correct. Recitation. If you think about it, the lessons that are being taught in this surah are very similar to those that were taught in Surah Tawbah. Isn't it, sir? Very similar themes. But they are very direct, straightforward, to the point. Because many times we make promises but we forget. So there is a powerful reminder towards the end of the Quran. Powerful reminder. Remember who you're working for. Remember what commitment you have made with who. And remember, there is a difference when you fulfill your commitment and you don't fulfill your commitment. And if you lose an opportunity, you might not get one again. Listen to the recitation of all of these ayats from the beginning. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته